I'm getting some reports of strange lights in the sky from the Oklahoma area. Our affiliate in Oklahoma City is telling us that the state police, get this, are reporting mysterious lights all over the area, and that they're having a hard time responding to all of the calls. It's going to be a wild and woolly night, folks. I just know it.
Stay tuned for important information.
Let's travel back in time to the simpler year of 2006, when shows like Ed, Edd n Eddy and Lost were gracing our television screens each night, and a little developer named Human Head Studios was finally releasing their game that had been announced over a decade earlier and swapped developers in that time. This game was called Prey. Not that one either. There we go. Prey is a sci-fi action blockbuster centering around Tommy Tawodi, a car mechanic living on a Cherokee reservation in Oklahoma with his grandfather and girlfriend Jen. The story picks up at a local bar as Tommy's trying to convince Jen to leave the reservation with him for more opportunities and a chance at a better life. This all takes a turn, however, when the national emergency broadcast comes on the TV, announcing that across the country, strange lights and objects are being reported in the sky. What began as an ordinary night turned to anything but that, as the lights go out and the roof of the bar gets ripped off. Green light fills the bar, and one by one, each of them is abducted by some sort of alien spacecraft. What follows is an action-packed adventure that sends Tommy on both a physical and spiritual journey to save not just his family, but the Earth itself. This spacecraft is beyond anything known to man, and seems to bend the laws of physics entirely, as anything from walking on the walls and ceilings to shrinking matter and teleporting is taking place on board. Without any weapons of his own, Tommy will have to reconnect with his Native American ancestors and adapt to use the weapons of his enemy to survive. Throughout this 7 or so hour epic, you'll shoot, explode, teleport, and more your way to the heart of the alien spaceship known as the Sphere to uncover the truth behind this invasion and to save your family. As I hinted at earlier though, you're not alone. Despite your better judgment, your grandfather convinces you to reconnect with your spiritual roots and to learn from your ancestors. This unlocks a sort of spirit world and power that will aid you throughout your journey by allowing you to face death head on and do things like walking clear through walls. Not only that, but you'll steal all manner of enemy weapons to use, from rocket launchers and energy blasters to poison bombs and goo shotguns. Speaking of weapons, there's a lot on offer here, as you'll end up with an arsenal of around 7 diverse tools of destruction. 7 weapons may not sound too impressive, but let me tell you, there's a lot more to these than meets the eye. Nearly all the weapons have different fire modes that act as multiple guns morphed into one. An example would be the Leech Gun, which absorbs around 4 different types of energy and lets you harness the powers of plasma, frost, lightning, and the sun itself to dispatch your foes. Each of these modes functions completely differently from one another and allow for hours of engaging combat scenarios. Another one of my favorites in the game would be the Acid Sprayer, which acts as a sort of poison shotgun. This mows down many of the lower end enemies throughout the game in glorious fashion. Then, the gun's secondary fire allows you to launch an entire vial of poison fluid at the enemy to nearly kill them in one shot. This secondary mode even allows you to bounce the vials off all manner of surfaces to get better vantage points in combat. While playing Prey, you'll need to vary up what weapon and modes you use, as each has a different level of effectiveness versus the numerous types of foes you'll face. The 13 plus types of creatures you'll face all pose different challenges that'll force you to change up your tactics on many occasions. While the standard rifle may work for the lowly cannon fodder, it'll prove to be somewhat of a pea shooter versus the more beastly enemies, like the massive demon-like Centurion. I found the combat in this game to be extremely satisfying, and at times even bordering on a horror game type feel due to the gory and dark levels and twisted Dead Space type enemies. You're even given a spirit guide in the form of your old pet hawk that'll help with puzzles and will attack your enemies with you. On top of all this, you can go into your spirit form, which allows you to pass through walls and over obstacles that were previously blocking your way. You even get to make use of your spirit bow that devastates enemies on direct hits with heavenly awesomeness. These combat sections are broken up when you encounter one of the flying vehicles in the game that lets you traverse large areas of the ship and fight in mid-air battles with one of two weapons. These sections were okay, but felt a bit basic as the flying mechanics are not very fleshed out, and the limit of two weapons bogged down the combat. Still, the tractor beam here was decently fun as it allowed you to kill enemies by throwing them or dropping objects on them. While for the most part great, I felt the combat had one other flaw. In later sections of the game, I actually found some of the enemies to be pretty big bullet sponges, and to take numerous shots to the head without even flinching, like in this section here. This doesn't hurt the overall experience too much though, as it only affects a very small portion of the game. Outside of this, and the flying sections feeling a bit long at times, the only other complaint I had was that there was a section where the frame rate dropped a significant amount. I ran the game on the Xenia Xbox 360 emulator, and I have a pretty beefy computer, so this may be more of a problem for others than me. In reality, this only affected a few seconds of my playthrough, but I figured I'd mention it in case it could affect somebody more. As I said though, I played on the Xenia emulator due to this game not being available to purchase on PC. Bethesda acquired the rights to this game at some point and decided to reboot the series despite there already being a trailer for Prey 2 that had a lot of people hyped and putting an advertisement for it in the box with Skyrim. Outside of Xenia, you can also get the game on Xbox. I'm not sure how the Xbox version runs, but the default in Xenia is 720p 30fps as that's how the original ran on the 360. I'll leave a link to a tutorial on how you can change the resolution to 1440p and get the framerate to 60fps in the description, because it improves the experience a good amount. Anyways, what else is there to do in Prey outside of blowing up alien baddies? Well, there's actually lots of physics and gravity puzzles you'll be faced with. I'm not usually the biggest fan of loads of puzzles in games, but I thought these were actually decently fun. The game feels like Portal before Portal at times. You'll have to make use of preset portals and all sorts of weird gravity tricks to progress. It could actually be a bit disorienting, and I could see it affecting some people, but it didn't bother me much. It never really got old, standing on the ceiling of a room watching the world's gravity completely flip and cause enemies and puzzle pieces to crash to the ground. As I usually say, it seems the gaming industry of the 2000s was just willing to take more risks and create more unique and mind-bending concepts. Yes, games of this era fail at some of their ideas, but when they're firing on all cylinders, they are true sights to behold. Prey is no exception. Another aspect of Prey I really enjoyed was the story and sort of underrunning message. At the start of the game, Tommy has completely forsaken the traditions, religion, and culture of his people in the Cherokee Nation. His only goal at the start is to leave the reservation and take his family with him. As the game progresses, however, Tommy slowly learns to connect back to his roots and embrace the ways of his family and his ancestors before him. Tommy mentioned at one point that he knows how to fight and learned that in the military. His grandfather stops him and tells him that he knows how to fight in the ways of the white man, but that he now needs to rely on his Native American weapon, being the spirit bow. Tommy's grandfather also refers to the aliens as the metal people and a number of other things throughout the game. This led me to thinking that Prey in some aspects is sort of a Native American power fantasy. Tommy's fighting back against the metal people who pervert the laws of nature and take as well as attack their land with his own tools and winning. His abductors were once the predators, and now he's made them the prey. I just thought this was a really cool concept, and as the game progresses, this narrative twists and turns, leading to a finale that I really enjoyed. Another thing I really liked was the little radio sections you hear throughout the game. Every once in a while, you'll stumble upon a console where the aliens have an Earth radio station set up, and the host takes callers from people all across the world who are updating him on weird sightings and legends that are matching up with what's happening now. These are nice lighthearted reprieves from action, and are great because they let you hear how things are going on Earth. All this and a soundtrack by the legendary Jeremy Soule, who's worked on games from The Elder Scrolls to KOTOR and Metal Gear Solid, leads to a great experience. Listening back to the soundtrack, I actually thought some of the songs reminded me a lot of Oblivion's soundtrack, which isn't too surprising considering that game released in the same year. In the end, Prey is a fantastic game, which is often overlooked due to its newer brother. I recommend any fans of the FPS genre, Halo games, Duke Nukems, and Dooms to try this game because it's just pure fun. For all these reasons and more, I'm giving the game an 8 out of 10.